And now, we've all seen the race, and you might even remember where you were when the Aussie saying, doing a Bradbury, was born. His Olympic moment is one of the most memorable in the history of sport. Here to tell us his amazing story of passion and persistence, please welcome Australia's first Winter Olympic golden medalist, Stephen Bradbury.
Last man standing is what I was dubbed by the world's media after that race. Exactly how did that happen? I trained for 12 years, competed for Australia in 4 Winter Olympic Games. The main reason that I was there in Salt Lake City was to put some demons to rest. In Canada 1994, I was impaled on the back of a rival skate, got my leg cut open, almost lost my life. 18 months before winning that gold medal, I had a crash in training, went headfirst into the barrier and broke my neck. I'd skated at 3 Winter Olympics, and I hadn't done my best at any of them, and I just wanted to skate my best. In Salt Lake City, I did that in the quarterfinals. I beat a 4-time world champion, made it through to the semis. I was pretty realistic about it and decided I don't think I'm as good as these other guys. And my best chance to get through to the final was to get on the ice in the semi and stay out the way. Figured there's no reason I should change my tactics for the final. Bring this on! Heading into the last turn, I see the Chinese guy fall. Set up my final turn out of the corner of my eye, I see the other three tumble. And from that moment, I knew. So I didn't have to skate anymore. All I had to do was glide across the finish line. I wasn't sure if I should put my arms up in the air in celebration or go and hide in the corner. Had no idea what the appropriate response was at that moment. I suppose in some people's mind, the question will always remain, did I win Olympic gold by accident? Half a dozen blokes had just fallen over and they wanted me to go up there and take a gold medal for it. I wasn't sure if I deserved to. I only had a few minutes to think about it, but during that few minutes, I decided, yeah, I'm going out there on the podium and I'm taking that gold medal, but I'm not taking it for the 90 seconds of that race. I'm going to take it for the 12 years in the lead up to that 90 seconds.
G'day. I like to kick things off with a little intro video. Otherwise, half of you guys are probably watching thinking, oh, that's pretty cool. Shannon Knowles here to sing for us. I've been mistaken for stacks of people over the years, the lead singer of Green Day and Linkin Park, and once a very elderly lady thought I was Billy Idol, and that's the day that I stopped dyeing my hair blonde. Now, I used to get invited to Hugh Hefner's place, the Logies, the Espies, the Formula One Grand Prix in Monaco. And now I'm talking to a camera thanks to the faculty and ICMI speakers. I'm talking to a camera in my own lounge room to a bunch of procurement officers for the CPO summit. Things are going bloody fantastic for Steve Bradbury. sorry, guys, that's just a joke. It is an absolute pleasure to be talking to you guys for the 2020 CPO summit. My wife and I, we had 3 kids under the age of 2, so it's a pleasure to be anywhere, guys. The COVID school lockdown is over. My kids are out of the house. Homeschooling, thank God, is complete. So anyone else out there? Can't see your hands, obviously. Anyone else got kids? Kids, yeah. Best day of your life when they're born. Some of you guys might be thinking, 3 kids under 2, that's pretty quick. How'd Steve and his wife do that? Well, twins, 3 under 2. There's my kids there on the screen. Little boy in the blue, little girl on the right. They're the twins. I take them down the shop sometimes. People come up to me and they say, hey, Steve, that's fantastic. I don't know you had twins. Next thing they say, are they identical? Not exactly. See the one in the blue? Got a penis. Yeah, so I'm going to share with you guys a little bit about my journey as an Olympian today, and I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the things that I think it means to be a success. That Olympic gold medal that you can see on your screen, that is what I thought success meant through the majority of my skating career. Now, when I won it, that's not exactly what I thought that success meant anymore. I'm going to try and explain a little bit about what I mean by that comment a bit later. Now, you guys think that success has got to do with not giving up. We're Aussies. We don't give up. You think it's got to do with steady progress towards your goals. Yeah? Show me your hands if you got goals. You got to have goals. You got to write it down. You got to have a plan. Your short, your medium, your long-term plan, and all those little things in between, which is a to-do list, not optional. And if you guys think that being successful in what you do here in procurement has sometimes got to do with being in the right place at the right time, well, then maybe me and you have got a few things in common. Now, I first started speed skating when I was 8. I used to watch my dad. He was the national champion in the sport a couple of times back in the 60s. Now, I saw the passion that my dad had for speed skating, and I thought, I want to have a go at this too. Now, the first time I skated, I got wet, I got cold, and I bawled my eyes out. Now, my mum, she took some photos that day. And when someone comes over to visit mum, even today, guess which photo she shows them. So that's the first time on skates with my dad. Speed skating, that's on the longer blades. 8 years of age, first time on skates, obviously right there, I'm a lot younger than 8 and I couldn't do it and I hated it. And my dad, he tells everyone, he says, yeah, Steve didn't skate again after that for about 4 years. I think he was a little bit traumatized. But I could see the passion my dad had for the sport. And after I got over myself, I started going back. I had a few more goes and I started to get a little bit of a feeling that I'd make my way across the ice. And I love the speed because I've always loved stuff that goes fast. Who likes stuff that goes fast? Adrenaline. I love that stuff. Adrenaline's fuel for your soul. I'm getting a bit of it right now talking to you lot. Now, on the screen there, that's my dad, John Bradbury. He was a pretty quiet father. He didn't push me hard when I was a kid moving through the age divisions in speed skating. I broke the national records as I moved through. I won the under 13 national speed skating championships when I was 10 years old. The kid who got the bronze medal also finished last. Yeah, popular sport in Australia, speed skating. But my dad, when I was a kid, he didn't push me. Well, not until I turned 13 anyway. The day after I was 13, he started dragging me out of bed every morning before he went to work, and he forced me to go running with him, and I hated it. Now, on the weekends, he put me behind him on a bicycle, kilometre after kilometre. I hated that too. I didn't get it. I couldn't see a point. The skating part of it, I had no problem with that because every time I get out there on the ice, I'm getting a little bit faster and I love it. But doing all these miles out on the road, it just hurt. Now, my dad, he did that to me because he was thinking, my son's pretty talented at this sport. He could have a future. Now, he could see something inside of me that I couldn't see. And I'll bet there's a few of you guys listening to this right now thinking, yeah, I know somebody like that. Pretty good, pretty talented at what they're trying to do, but they can't see it yet for the big picture. Now, that person, that could be someone you work with, could be one of your kids, could be you. Now, if you're thinking of someone, don't give up on them because there's different stages in all of our lives where we can benefit from somebody else coming along and kicking us up the butt. Now, when I was a kid, 13, 14, 15 years of age, with my dad pushing me so hard, I hated what he did to me back then. Anyone think I'll thank him for it now? 100%. Now, growing up in the Bradbury family house, pretty strict environment. Me and my younger brother, Warren, we didn't get away with much when we were kids. We tried. We'll always see what sort of mischief that we could get into. And if it was just my mum around, like that particular day, we could push the boundaries. No way we're doing that if my dad was there. So I was 10, my brother was 7.
and we both found a pretty good sized magnet in the old man's garage. Now, I'm not sure if anyone here's ever done this before, but if you get a magnet and you put it on the TV, anyone know what that does? Magnet on the TV screen? It makes a purple dot on the screen. Now, me and my brother, we're having a fantastic time. We're running this magnet around the TV set, changing people's heads on the screen into a purple dot. Now, what we didn't realize, if you hold the magnet in the same spot for too long, purple dot stays on the TV. Now, if you know my dad, when he comes in from work, he's sitting down in front of the TV to relax. Me and my brother, we're shitting ourselves. We're thinking about packing up our bags and moving out. But we're only 10 and 7. We don't have a choice. We switched that TV off. Way too scared to put it back on. Sat down on the couch and waited. Now, it was only a few minutes until Dad was due in from work. He was right on time. He walked in the front door. He looked at me and my brother sitting there on the lounge in front of the TV with the TV switched off. Now, eventually, he turned around again. He switched the TV back on and the purple dot had disappeared. Now, I think that was the first time in my life when all of my prayers were most definitely answered. Now, many years later, I won the Southern Hemisphere's first Winter Olympic gold medal. And maybe that was another time when all my prayers were answered. I represented Australia at the Winter Olympics 4 times. I was ranked inside the top 10 speed skaters in the world for over a decade, and then I became an overnight success. Now, my mum and dad, they went to watch me race at the 4th and final Olympics that I skated in Salt Lake City. They saved up for a year and a half to afford to get there. They did that because they love their kids and they support them. I did it because I love the sport. I love the competition. And as I said before, I love the speed. And like every single person watching this right now, I love to win. Does it feel good when you win? It feels good. Now, if you're going to get that win or keep tasting the success that you might already be tasting a little bit of as a procurement officer, then you have to have some passion for what you do. You got to want it. You're showing up to work every day. You're walking around a little bit like a zombie with your brain only switched off on because you've been eating McDonald's all week and you feel like shit, or you're hungover a bit too often, or you're negative all the time because of this COVID thing, then you're going to be showing up with a bit of negativity going on in your brain. And that negative gets you nowhere. You've got to show up with passion. You have to want it. Now, I used to have a sign stuck to the ceiling in my bedroom. It read, "This is the Olympics. Get up." Now, that's the first thing I see every morning at 4:30 when my alarm's going off. And I know my competition on the other side of the world, I know they're getting out of bed. And if I don't get up and I lose, I got to live with that regret. And that word sucks. Now, as procurement officers, you guys are in a situation right now where it's your opportunity to shine. The spotlight is on you. The balance sheet at your business needs your attention, and it's your time to make the moves, bend those suppliers over backwards, get better deals, get things cheaper, get the job done. Now, as a speed skater, I used to train 12 sessions a week, 2.5 hours in the morning, 2.5 hours in the afternoon, 6 days a week, Sundays off. Heaps of time in the preseason riding my bicycle up and down mountains, about 400 kilometers a week. Endurance, pushing weights in the gym, strength, I used to be able to squat 240 kilos. Heaps of time in a place that I used to call the Big Fridge, the ice rink out in the western suburbs here in Brisbane at Acacia Ridge. Anyone else lived in Acacia Ridge before? No? And I can tell you it's not exactly Brisbane's classiest suburb. I spent thousands of hours in Ice World at Acacia Ridge, sprint work, endurance work, technical work. Only other person in Australia spent almost as much time on the ice as me, Ben Cousins. Now, that didn't go as well the first time I used it at the West Coast Eagles season launch breakfast in Perth. And one of the things that I loved about my sport was the competition. I've always been competitive. I don't like to lose at anything. If I was playing Monopoly with my brother when we were kids, if he was winning, I'd cheat. Had anybody have that sort of mindset when they were a kid? Cheat to win? Yeah, I know a few of you did. You're supposed to grow out of that when you get a bit older. Took Lance Armstrong a little bit longer. Anyway, so I'm going to try and get a little bit of audience participation through the camera here right now. So I need all of you guys to slide your chair back that you're sitting in and actually stand up for me. Let's have a go. We're going to have a shot at an exercise that I used to do as part of my speed skating training. It's pretty simple. Get the chair out of the way from behind you. We're going to get into a speed skating squat position. Get your elbows under your knees. Stick your hands behind your back. Keep your head up. We're going to see who the last man standing is here now. And the winner gets a signed copy of my book to go with it. Is anyone else still going? I'm not sure how well this is going to work through the camera. But, I'm starting to get a bit of lactic acid in the legs, so hopefully you guys are getting a taste of that too, if you got off your chair, that is. All right, so thank you very much if you managed to participate for a moment or two in that. Now, like everyone, I had some painful times in my skating career. I had another guy's blade go clean through my right leg. I got 131 stitches in my leg. I went headfirst into the barrier during a training crash out at Acacia Ridge and broke my neck. So I definitely had my share of misfortune through my skating career, but there is one moment in my skating career that most people remember, and we're going to relive that race on the screen now.
That's Apollo Ono, the American pre-race favourite. He's on the RBC boots, don't forget.
There he is, the hometown favourite.
Apollo's on a pair of skating boots that myself and my business partner made him. We actually sold that business to China back in 2012.
This is right where Apollo Ono wants to be, right where he expected to be. Let's see if he can light the fireworks up and take home a gold medal.
Zhao Junli from China. Three-time Olympic silver medalist before this race. I can guarantee he's not interested in finishing second anymore.
Jia Jun Lee, he'll be in fourth position.
Hansu Ahn from South Korea, 16 years old. He's also known as Harry Potter.
In two. Ono in three.
Matthew Turcotte from Canada.
Lee from China in four. And Stephen Bradbury, that man right there, skating for his place in Australian sporting immortality. A huge roar as Bradbury gets introduced. Bronze, Australia's best at the Winter Games.
Commentators talking about the bronze medal that you guys are having a look at here today. Hopefully it's still here.
Meters relay team claimed bronze in 1994 Lillehammer. Of course, Zali Stegall bronze in the slalom at Nagano.
I knew I'd had some luck to make the final. I was really excited to be out there on the ice.
He knows already the worst he can finish is fifth in the final of the men's 1,000.
Commentator's confident.
This guy is magic, aren't they?
Spoke to my coach again. We concluded that none of the other four skaters were interested in finishing second. They all wanted gold. And that meant a good chance of another crash and a good chance of a bronze medal for me.
There it is for Bradbury. One of just four Australians to contest four Olympic Winter Games into the A final. Five people in this final, gold, silver and bronze. Bradbury closest to the fence, fifth position for the start. Away they go. Stephen Bradbury was content in his semi to sit at the back, and it looks like he'll do that again just here.
1,000 metres.
9 laps for the kilometre. Top speed, 54 kilometres an hour.
With him is Ono. The Canadian tucked back third. That's Turcotte. Ono pushing up now. There will be a lot of jockeying for position here. This is extremely important not to waste too much energy bumping and fighting the other skaters. Apollo looks like he's going to settle back into fourth position. Does not want to burn too much energy.
On the inside, the yellow and blue, the young Korean hits the front. Speed's picking up.
Same with Bradbury sitting in the back. Bradbury can sit on Apollo's lead. See if he goes with Apollo here on the outside. Pace starts to quicken. Look at Ono. Finds a way. Skates into second position. Sitting on the tail of Arn. A bit of contact there. Less than 4 laps remaining. Stephen Bradbury still back in fourth. But this race is by no means over. It's the Korean Arn first. Ono skating in second position. The Chinese competitor lead third.
Apollo Ono moves on the outside. That's an incredible pass. He takes the lead. On the inside, moving from third to second, the Chinese.
It's going to be very hard to pass Apollo Ono once this guy gets to the lead. He's almost impossible to pass. Skates a great track, holds the corners tight. But the Chinese skater on the outside, oh, and it's a lot of contact. Oh, they've all gone down. Bradbury is going to come through and win gold. Stephen Bradbury from the tail of the field. The Australian has crossed the line first. We will have to wait for the official confirmation. Stephen Bradbury, the 28-year-old from Brisbane. Has he done it?
Listen to the commentator here.
Oh, my gosh, what a great race there for Stephen. Absolutely great strategies, just sitting in the back, waiting for things to happen, and quite possibly gold medal. Does Australia have its first Olympic Winter Games gold medal? 1936, our first winters, 2 bronze medals. Stephen Bradbury, has he won gold? I have to think he does, Basil.
What's the Chinese skater in second position, moving on the outside? What's his left arm?
Ono. Going out of his lane, sticking out his right arm. I have to think a disqualification there for Apollo Ono, which will be a huge surprise. Korean coming out.
Commentator
the inside
doesn't
there.
See it. Hard one Lux to see. Chinese skater
balance,
does get disqualified.
Takes out Turcotte, the Canadian. Ono also going down, and Bradbury coming to the gold medal. Watch it. Watch it. Stephen Bradbury there.
Watch the left arm of the Chinese. Goes for his knee. Doesn't get it. The American fights him off. Chinese goes down first.
I have to think Apollo Ono is going to be disqualified. And he's also trying to impede the Koreans' progress there on the inside. And it's roller derby from there on in. Skaters all over the place. And Bradbury quietly walking into the gold medal.
And that was officially how I became the last man standing. Now my mum and dad were there. They were in the crowd. They had seats 4 rows from the top, 16,500-seat stadium. Now all these other skaters fell over on the last corner. Everybody in the crowd stood up in front of them and they didn't see what happened. Mum said, "What just happened?" And dad said, "Oh, bugger if I know, but I think he just won." And now for me, it was incredibly special to be able to share in all of that with my parents because they had been the biggest part of my support team ever since I'd started. And there's no way that I would have been there without that support. And I think especially in today's ultra-competitive world, it's getting harder to be an expert at anything if you try to do it by yourself. Business or sport, you have to have a team of people around you that you can rely on for support and for help. Even though we're not all sitting in a room together right now, we can pick up the phone, we can work on the internet and use the support network that we have around us. Now, some of those people, I bet, are also listening to this presentation right now. And you guys probably know each other, but you haven't really shared what you're an expert at because Australians are not that good at sharing with each other what we're good at. Would you agree? Sometimes we're a bit scared we're going to get called a show off. But if you're able to help somebody in procurement and they win Procurement Officer of the Year, is there an award for that? I don't know. But if you help them and they win, that should make you feel good. That's karma. Now, with or without COVID-19, every organization will succeed or fail based on how the people, systems, and processes work together. Now, for me, the question that I've been asked probably the most since I won Olympic gold is, how did I feel when I crossed the line? Now, straight after the race, I wasn't sure how I'd answer that question. I mean, I knew that it felt great, but I didn't know what I was going to say when the whole world asked me if I think I deserved to win or not. And I was sitting in the change rooms after the race, and at this point, I wasn't sure if I was even going out onto the podium to accept the gold. But I had a few minutes to think about it, and I thought about my whole skating career, and I'd skated through 4 Olympics. I was ranked number 1 in the world 8 years earlier, and I got taken out. I was left sitting there on the ice thinking, this is bullshit. I had to skate through my leg. I broke my neck. I thought, in the semifinals and the final, I've just had 7 other skaters fall over in front of me. And after all this stuff that's happened to me, training so hard for so long, that's what they want me to take a gold medal for. For a bunch of blokes falling over in front of me. And I thought, I can't take a gold medal for that. But what I can take this gold medal for is the 14 years of hard work in the lead up. That's what I can take it for. Now, I've been able to do some pretty cool stuff since I won this. I got to ride in the 2-seater Formula One car at the Grand Prix. I got to carry the flag at the closing ceremony at the Winter Olympics in Salt Lake City. Now, that is a proud day to be an Aussie. I went on Dancing with the Stars. It's not such a proud day to be an Aussie. Not when one of the judges gives you 3 out of 10 and you're the first one voted out anyway. Now, I'm the only person listening to this who can lick the back of their own head. I got to meet Richard Branson, fully organized media event in Sydney, TV, newspapers, radio. The room is packed with media. So Richard Branson presents me with a mobile phone. I got to make free calls on it for 4 years. That was pretty good. Following that, he gives me a signed copy of his book. That's pretty good too. Next, Richard Branson presents me with a Virgin Mobile cap. Now, one of the richest men in the world presents you with a cap with his company logo on it at a media conference. You probably figure the cap goes on your head. I got flustered. I got nervous. I was new to all the cameras and stuff, and I didn't know what to do. I looked at the hat, looked back at him. I had a pen too, so I signed the hat, gave it back to him. Now, has anyone here heard of the saying, he's done a Bradbury? They put it into the Macquarie Dictionary in 2014. You can use it if you want. There's a guy who wrote a book and he called it, Could You Do a Bradbury? It's sales and marketing. Now, I'm not going to go through all the content within his book with you guys this afternoon. But if you're showing up every day and you're doing your best, suddenly disaster strikes, maybe one of your competition goes bankrupt, you see it come and launch a promotional campaign, pinch all their customers while they're on the floor, not fall, get a gold, do a Bradbury. It has been a pleasure sharing a little bit of my Olympic story with you guys here this afternoon. I'm going to be joining you guys for questions shortly. I'm hoping that there's a couple of things from my short presentation today that you guys can take with you and store it in the back of your brain and use it on that rainy day for when things didn't exactly go quite the way that you planned that they would. Maybe this. It's a long show. I'd like to thank everyone from the faculty at CPO Summit. Has been a pleasure sharing a little bit of my Olympic story with you guys. If you're interested in a little bit more of my story and some signed copies of my book, a lot of inspiration in there. They're at stephenbradbury.com. Now, occasionally, people come up to me, and this doesn't happen very often because the people who tell me this, usually they're sitting at home in their lounge room not doing too much, but sometimes people come up to me and they say, geez, you're lucky, mate. Now, my coach, she doesn't say that. She tells me that I gave my heart, my youth, and almost my life pursuing that golden dream, and it would never have come true if I wasn't the last man standing. Now, I think you guys would agree that winning that gold medal takes a lot more than just luck. And if you're willing to give all of yourself to something, work through the difficult times, be passionate about what you do, work together as a team, then eventually your moment to shine will present and you too can be the last one standing. Thanks very much.